How are you guys doing?
We're good.
When did this all start? When did you guys connect for the first time? How long ago was that?
Boy, I don't know when we actually connected. I mean, it's probably a couple years now, right?
Yeah, I think it was January 2012. I first got a call from Grant asking me could I come out and meet with him and talk to him about the story. And about a week or two later, I spent a week out there in their office having a chat.
So did you just randomly read the book over Christmas, or?
Well, it wasn't over Christmas, but I did just randomly read the book, yeah. And and that was probably about a year before that. I'd read it and thought it could make a great film, but we were in the middle of, George and I were in the middle of doing The Ides of March. So we were in the headspace of sort of, you know. And then we were sitting in our office after we'd finished that film and trying to figure out what our next film was going to be. And I said, you know, I read this book. It's a fantastic story. It's a story I hadn't really heard before. It's a period that we love. We've never done a war movie. You should read this. And he said, that sounds great. And he read it, and he agreed. And we optioned the book from Robert and got going on it.
Were you expecting somebody to want to option your book for a movie? Do you think that was a likelihood when you wrote the book?
Yeah, that was the objective. I mean, I really wanted this story to be told worldwide, a worldwide audience, and someone that had the vision to want to, and vision and ambition to think no small thoughts and make the big story. And that's a, you know, telling a period story's always a challenge. And it's in particular something that is on the scope and scale of this. Mm. And there were other opportunities along the way, but I felt, you know, someone's going to pick off the small portion of the story and then the big story doesn't get told. And I have the great admiration for Grant and George because they saw the bigness of it and weren't intimidated by it. In fact, I think that was a
we were a little intimidated.
And you know, here we are. I mean, they've thrown themselves into it and their passion's evident in the result.
So was that it, the conversation from the beginning? Were you guys on the same page in terms of what kind of movie would come out of this, or what your angle was on?
I think so. Yeah. I mean, you have to understand that this is a huge story, and the book is dense. There's a lot of information, and so, you know, we know from the outset we're going to make a 2-hour film. So we have to be, you know, you have to go in with a machete, and that's the tricky task for all of us.
Yeah.
So what was the most important was, okay, what's the spirit of this story? What is it we want to say with this story? Mm. And then sort of, kind of almost reverse engineer it, that's how we worked.
So is that, were you guys in touch during all that, or do you kind of?
Well, what happened
get
was
to the point where you trust and then start working.
Well, the way that George and I, what we did is we did two things. One is, we hired a researcher, a guy who did the research for us on Argo, a great researcher. And we just said, go out and just get us everything on this period. We want photos, we want maps, we want timelines, we want to know about these characters, you know, whatever you can give us. And we have a big conference room in our office, and we just covered the place with material.
Wallpapered it.
Yeah, it was really, and then we had Robert lives in Dallas, we had him come out for a week and basically just give us a class. We went through history with him, and it was, you know, 8 hours a day. We sat in this same room, and George and I just took notes. And it was through that process where you start to see, okay, here's the shape, and then George and I spent another, you know, few weeks just figuring out then what the story beats are. You know, literally 3x5 cards, putting them up on a wall, moving them around.
Mm-hmm.
And then, we sort of talked about that, and then we went off and wrote.
Is that how you guys generally are in terms of how you work together?
No, because this film had such a particular story and history that, we needed to do a lot of research. You know, for something like The Ides of March, we didn't have to do any research. You know, that was something we just sat down and wrote.
And you had Bo. I guess.
Well, we had source material, but we didn't write that with Bo.
Right.
You know, so we, but we had, you know, we had a play to work off of in that case. But even Good Night and Good Luck, which is also a history piece, this is a huge story. So it needed an amount of research that we hadn't had to do before.
So the point at which he comes out and comes to your office and you guys spend time talking about it, do you then marry that idea? Are you monogamous once you've decided what you guys are interested in doing next, as opposed to developing four or five different things at the same time and kind of figuring out what can get funded or what's going to happen next?
Are you talking about while we're working on Monuments Men?
Yeah, I mean, once you kind of decided you were all on the same page and you wanted to work on the script, are you then, the two of you then, kind of committed 100% to one project at a time?
To writing, yeah. But, we have a company and we've got people, so we're constantly developing other material with other writers and stuff. But we only write one thing at a time. We only concentrate. Mm-hmm. Once we say we're going to make it, we're going to make it. And that's where all our energy goes. Mm.
So how was it for you in terms of figuring out, did you know kind of what that you wanted the theme to be, this theme yourself? Well, or were you kind of... Were there multiple options of what you might be happy about?
At the end of the day, they're the storytellers on film. I mean, this is the challenge that I think the great success of the collaboration here. I mean, as a writer of this and understanding the history of it, I'm confined to what the historical record is. But I have as many pages to tell it as I want to. From Grant and George's standpoint, they have more latitude with respect to the historical record, but they're confined with 2 hours, 2 hours 15, whatever, and it goes by really, really quick. They have another burden, too, that I pay them great compliment for. You know, there have been so many stories told about World War II that the public has a lot of information in their minds that alleviates some pressure on filmmakers to not have to go back and educate them on that. And in this case, there are no other films that have told the story of the Monuments Men and the magnitude of this looting during World War II. So from their standpoint, over and above trying to find a way to embrace such a complicated and expansive story geographically, they're trying to make sure that the public has the information that they need to really appreciate the story and know who these people are and why they did what they did. And I think that was a big challenge and something they hit the mark on.
Thank you.
So how did you get to this story in the first place?
I came to it by accident, and I think I came to it the way the audiences are going to, which is, you have some knowledge about World War II. We all feel like we know a little bit about it, but you start to think about, well, how in a war that cost the lives of 65 million people and so much devastation did all these works of art and churches and things survive, and who are the people that saved them?
Mm. But what specifically, were you just, because I don't know the answer to this question either, were you just interested in were you a history buff of World War II and then you just stumbled upon the story and said, well, this is something I don't know about, I want to know more about? Or, I mean, how did that come about?
Yeah, to a degree. I mean, I'd sold my business before. I had an oil and gas exploration business, and I was the same age as these Monuments officers, 42 years old, with a son about the same age, 3. I wasn't seeing him. I was so busy working, and there were other things I was interested in. I felt I was never going to have time, and what was driving me was meaningfulness. It was not money. And I thought, if I don't carve out some time to have time to learn about other things, then I'm going to be on this treadmill, and then I'll be 60 or 70. It's going to be hard to make changes. So my wife and I and son of two moved to Europe, settled in Florence, and I started studying art and architecture, because what else do you do in Florence? And I was reading 10 books a week, which if you don't start reading at 10:30 at night, you can read a lot of books. And I had this epiphany walking across the Ponte Vecchio one day, the only bridge in Florence that wasn't blown up by the Nazis in August 44 when they fled. And I thought, how in the world could I know anything about World War II? I felt I knew a little bit, and not have thought about what happened to the art. So World War II is the most documented period in history, most photographed period in history, and I kept looking for books, photographs and stuff of this period, and there weren't any. And I got lured into it. I couldn't see that I was being lured into it, but by the time I started really getting involved, then in 2003, in the aftermath of American invasion in Iraq with the looting of museum in Baghdad, I thought, well, I don't totally understand what took place during World War II, but I understand enough to know in a world war we did really noble things. And not to make light of the difficulties in Iraq, but it's a smaller regional conflict. How could we not have thought of having Monuments Men then? And that's really when I started throwing myself into it, thinking, this is a great story. And no one has stopped me over the last 4 or 5 years to say, oh, we know that story. Everyone wants to know more about it. So that must be a barometer here that I'm onto something. Hmm. So that's really, how we got to this stage.
So do you take to it as a journalist, right? I mean, do you take to journalism as an idea of what you were
No, I look at myself as a storyteller. I mean, and just a different medium than Grant and George, and really a messenger. And that's why I think this collaboration, from my views, works so well. I mean, what I asked for at the outset was to be heard, and to be able to share my ideas and thoughts. And George and Grant, their door was always open. We didn't always agree. We had difference of views on some things, but it was always towards working towards a common goal and I believe a respect on my part that you all are the storytellers and in the quarterback seat in this medium, and I'm deferring to their experience there. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, I want to see the most, I think this is the most exciting story I've ever heard. I want to see the most exciting, dramatic telling of it on film. And they have more experience. They know how to do that. I don't.
So what is your goal and when as you guys proceed on it? Are you thinking of that you want to express a piece of history that nobody knows about, or are you, what intrigued you guys about
it? Well, that's part of it. I mean, that was this was a story that we didn't know anything about, and it was a way to do a war film that we hadn't seen before. You know, and we were always interested in doing a World War II film, sort of the films that we grew up on, you know, in the 70s and even the 60s, some that were before us, just, you know, and you don't really see films like that. And so we wanted to make one of those films. We wanted to make an entertaining film, and we thought that this could be a really, you know, it could be a great ride. Mm-hmm. And we also liked the idea of, you know, along the way, if it could help raise a discussion about, like, where, you know, there's still a ton of art that hasn't been found and repatriated, and that's, you know, that are hanging in museums. I mean, it's everywhere, and it's a slow process to get this stuff returned. But if this can help, at least raise a discussion, that's also a nice byproduct.
But I think you know, one of the things that we talked about too, there's a hopefulness to this story.
I mean,
it's not like a lot of other World War II stories that focus only on the tragedy. You've got men and women that are becoming a new kind of soldier who volunteered to save rather than destroy. And I think that's another new ground of World War II storytelling that's not as common.
Yep.
So when you start casting after you're done with the script, did you guys think, okay, we need to get the funniest cast in the history of movies? Or?
No, you know, the truth is we wrote the script with just about everybody in mind.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
So, you know, we wrote that with Kate in mind. We wrote it with Bill in mind. You know, Matt. We wrote with John Goodman. The only one that we didn't write it with. We didn't know who was going to play the role that Bob Balaban ended up playing, and we didn't know who was going to play the kid because we knew that was going to be somebody that we were just going to find.
Right.
And we ended up running into Bob at an event, actually for an Argo event, and we were like, he could do it. And so I called him the next day and said, hey, we've got this script if you're interested.
And Jean just wandered in as he grabbed his Academy Award. And
Jean, we wrote that role with Jean in mind. That role is fictional. One of the more fictional roles.
Composite.
Mm-hmm. It's a composite of several characters, but we knew we wanted him, and you know, he turned out to be like one of the greatest sort of joys of making the film. Just meeting him, becoming friendly with him, and hanging around him. He's a great dude.
So was it? I mean, is it like the Dirty Dozen? Is it the, you know, Kelly's Heroes? And
well, those were all
those
film,
the movies that are inspiring.
Those were all inspirations for this film. Yeah, for sure.
Because Desplat's score really has the spirit of those.
Yeah, well, we talked about
Great Escape and.
Yeah, that was a big conversation that we had with them. We wanted a score. We wanted a tune that you could go out whistling.
And did casting him in the movie was a
that was
left
George,
field or?
That was just George. When we wrote that, George was like, we should get him to play it. He looks like a character out of Ratatouille. You know, I mean, he's like a really classic. He's got such a strong, classic face. He's got a great face.
Yeah.
And that again, he was one that we thought about.
This is a heavy cameo movie, really, in some ways. It's like, I think I was maybe the only person laughing in the theater because I no display a little bit, and so it was like, oh. And then you were brilliant in it as well.
Well, mine was the case of mine was the guy that we cast. Unfortunately, his wife fell ill, and so he couldn't come that day, and so I stepped in.
But you've been in most of the George's movies, haven't you? Have you been in all of them?
I wasn't in
Confessions.
I wasn't in Confessions. Mm-hmm. And I wasn't in The Ides of March.
You weren't in? Oh, okay. Do you miss acting at all?
I do miss it. Like when I did that, mm-hmm. I was like, oh, this is fun. It's fun just only worrying about your little part.
Yeah.
And it's fun to do. And so, yeah, I miss that part, the actual acting part. I don't miss the rest of it. I don't miss, like, you know, I don't miss that. I don't miss, you know, waiting to hear if you got the role or not. I don't miss any of that.
And do you guys, is there a pressure now that you guys have had such a great track record, film after film after film, of delivering, you know, obviously the award season was an issue this year and when the movie was going to come out and all of that. Is there a weight that comes with that as a producer? Or?
I think there's a self-imposed sort of, I think it has less to do, I think it just has more to do with our own, the idea that we want to keep making films that don't, it doesn't feel like we're repeating ourselves and that we're breaking some new ground or trying something. That's the pressure that I think both of us feel and put on ourselves. I mean, look, the truth is that, you know, it's hard to make a great film. I don't mean hard like, you know, like people who work hard doing hard labor, right. You know, but it's there's a lot of luck involved and there's a lot of timing and a lot of stuff. So you just, every time you go out, you just sort of, you get up to bat and you do the, make the best film you can make.
Try and maintain a standard of excellence.
Yeah.
And I know, you know, there was a frustration expressed by some about the delay, and you know, I got asked about that, and I said, hey, look, you know, you can't rush excellence. If we need more time to do something, special effects, et cetera, it's like, make it great.
Yeah, well, the thing is, you know, we had that date, and we just, if we were gonna make that date, we were gonna make some serious compromises in the way the film looked.
Mm-hmm.
And at the end of the day, we decided we'd rather, you know, we'd rather release the film that we want to make.
It is the award season has a weird effect on people.
And
in some ways, getting away from it is probably a good thing in terms of.
We don't mind getting away from it because the truth is you know, this is. I don't think we ever made a film where we set out to say this is going to be an award film, but this is a film that we set out to make that we knew we wanted to be entertaining and to appeal to a very wide audience, and so there wasn't any, I mean, you know, any of the awards talk that was out there had nothing to do with us. It's mm-hmm. you know, it just has to do with you know, all those sites that say, okay, here's what's coming out. So
and so had you moved back to Dallas when this was being made, or?
Well, I seem to be somewhat single-handedly keeping American Airlines in business, so I'm flying around everywhere most of the time because everything I need somewhere else, whether it's interviewing World War II veterans or their kids, things that surfaced that have been stolen during the war that as part of the Monuments Men Foundation we help get back.
So you're still deep into this?
Oh, oh yeah, completely. Yeah, this has been my life last
He's obsessed.
12 years. Yeah, guilty as charged. But it's a great story, and as Grant said, I mean, there's so many, it's such a contemporary story, not only with protection of works of art and cultural treasures in the future and other conflicts, but it's the altered legacy we're left with from World War II, the unfinished business of things that are still missing, and I think this film's going to change our world in a lot of positive ways with respect to making worldwide awareness of what took place during the war and reestablishing that high bar, but also letting people know that there's things missing and people have inherited stuff. They don't know what they've got, where it came from, or who to call if they found something. So this is just one of the different aspects that's going to encourage people, I think, to come forward and continue that dialogue long after the film's been out there. And I think years from now, when we look back and wonder how people have become more aware about this, we've done it in a way using the medium that's the most effective way to reach the most number of people, which is feature film.
So you're not your traditional book writer who sold the book You're deep in. And is this your second act of your life, would you say?
I mean, is this third, I would say, because I had this first period wanting to be a professional tennis player. But I will say I haven't had a traditional experience here, and that's partly due to Grant and George embracing my passion for the story and knowledge and wanting me to be involved in the process, and our researchers as well. It was a very, very proud and grateful moment. The first day we were on set, I was able to take the researchers I have that have put so much time into this and bring them to the set with Grant's encouragement. And you know, it's not often that you have a chance to let the people that are doing such hard work at a ground level, that's critical work, have a chance to participate in some of the fun aspects of it. And that was a real joy for me to be able to see them be there and see what it's all about.
So did anything change when they showed up? Had you gotten anything wrong that needed to be moved to the left or?
No, that particular day was, I think we were shooting Kate. It was Kate in the
Kate bar, first, yeah. And then the scene with Matt and George there at the bar.
Yeah, so these were not
mine scenes?
No. Not mine scenes. Were you there for any of the mine scenes?
Not for the shooting, but we had a chance to wander through the Babelsberg sets, yeah, and see really unbelievable work on the part of prop masters and everything on recreation of events. And anyone seeing this film, and I have some expertise to say this, I mean, the recreation of works of art, the degree of effort to make them look authentic and stuff, it's extraordinary. You're stepping back in time and being as close to the events as you could be.
And watching some of them burn, which is,
yeah,
gotta be
it's
surreal.
Painful. It's painful, but I mean, some of these events took place.
Yeah. Even the fakes that we burned, it was painful.
So the I don't know if the end of the movie has it, because I don't think I saw the end of the credits, but is there like a go-to www for people who want to know more about what you're doing?
Well, we're doing a lot of that through our online stuff, and the studio, Sony and Fox and Grant and George have been very supportive. We've created a 1-866 World War II art phone number, WWIIART, for people to come forward if they think they've got something, mm-hmm, or are curious about it, and contact the foundation. We don't charge anybody for it. And like I feel similarly to them, if the film can stir some things loose and shake the snow globe and help get some things back to the rightful owners, then that's a fantastic legacy of the film.
So we talked to Faden for Nebraska, actually, but we talked a little bit about doing this movie, and he was saying that George is really like two shots maximum, two takes maximum George. He's not going to go to the fourth at all, ever. Is that, has he been that way before? Is that help you as a producer?
That's not quite accurate. He'll go as many as he needs, yeah, to get it, but right, you know, it's usually a couple takes, and he's always been that way. Yeah, he's always been. He's very concise. He knows exactly what he wants. Mm-hmm. Everything is preset. Everything is, you know, ready to go. And you know, it's how he is as an actor too. You know, he's not a guy who loves to do, you know, tons and tons of takes. You know, it's, mm-hmm, sort of like.
So he won't be doing a Fincher movie anytime soon.
Well, I can't say who we'll work with, but he's certainly, you know, some actors love to do, you know, tons of takes, and yeah, some.
So does that help you as a producer? I mean, do you know when you lock down your days? Are you feeling?
It helps me as a producer because we never go over. We never work long days. We rarely go into overtime. We generally come in under schedule, and
in this situation with the challenges, yeah, of the weather
and under budget usually. I mean, just because, mm-hmm, you know, because there are ramifications for that run down the line. Not, I mean, particularly when you shoot film, which we did shoot, mm-hmm, on this, because you're shooting less film, you're processing less film, you know, so that all adds up.
Mm. But it seems like it's a really great way to work.
It's a great way to work for everybody, because, you know, happy crew, happy actors, you know, and the thing is that you can only do that if you really know what you want. Mm-hmm. You know, if you don't really know what you want, you don't really have a strong point of view, then, you know, you're going to have to do more coverage, more takes. But because George really has a strong point of view, you know, he gets it. If he gets it on the first take, he moves on.
So is that decisiveness there when you guys are writing, or does it start when he puts on the director's hat and He's ready to go to that war?
No, or? I think when we're writing, there's more, you know, there's more give and take, I think, you know, because when you're writing, you're not under the pressure of the production, you know, you don't have hundreds of people standing around waiting. So that's where we try to get all the kinks out so that when we go to shoot, we're not dealing with that stuff.
Professional.
Try to be.
Like the good old days, but better. So when was the first time you saw the movie put together?
A few weeks ago. Both of them were gracious in helping me not get on an airplane and made arrangements for me to see it in Dallas, where I happen to be, and took a couple of our researchers, and it was a great experience.
Were you nervous when it started, when it came up on the screen?
Not entirely, because I'd been there enough on set on three different occasions, and I mean, I knew the script, and I knew how hard they'd worked at it. I think, echoing what Grant said, a lot of the surprises and guesswork's taken out of it because the preparation's gone into it on the front end. So, yes, you want to see how it's realized by the time it makes it to film, but as far as knowing which people are going to be saying what, but I was hugely excited. I mean, the idea of seeing this thing come to life and having had a vision that I had many, many years ago brought to life with the music and the incredible performances, the deeply moving performances, and seeing how hard all these actors worked to really understand who these characters were and what made them tick. Mm. Yeah, it's there.
So, have you seen it with an audience yet?
No, that I have not done yet.
Excited about that prospect?
Yeah, I am. I absolutely am. I mean, I'm just excited.
I am, because he only saw it with a few people, but when you see the film, you know, most films, but a film like this in particular, when you see it with an audience, it brings a whole other level to it.
And we felt that when we were watching it. It's like, you know, well, no one else is laughing because it's just the few of you, and no one else is crying yet. So it's kind of a strange situation, and we didn't have all the credits on it yet. So, I mean, I haven't seen it with all the bells and whistles, but yeah, we're really excited to see that.
Well, I've seen it with audiences. It's great.
It's one of those weird things when you're sitting in a room by yourself or with two people watching a movie where there's laughter and there's excitement and whatever, and you're kind of like, you feel like an idiot sometimes laughing out loud. But
I suppose the moment for me, perhaps, that you're trying to put your finger on occurred, and it happened the very first day we were there on set, when in a scene with George and Matt, when they first discuss, George is trying to recruit Matt into this, and Matt looks at this letter and says, "Monuments Men," and there was a chill that went down my spine, because now something's being spoken that I've put all this time into it, and they've captured it in a script, and now you hear it, and it's really like going to the delivery room, seeing your baby right there coming to life. So for me, that the immediacy of that was more moving in a way, and then the film's just very different in that respect.
And you're not likely to write something else next year that's going to be a different movie.
Well, my next book tells the story of what the Monuments Men did in Italy, focused on that, and it's out. It's a New York Times bestseller called Saving Italy.
But unless there's a sequel, you're not going to write a book about, you know, childbirth and see a movie made of that.
I tell people when they come and say, you know, what
are you
going to do?
You never know with this guy.
I tell people when you come and they say, what are you doing next? It's like, look, it's like asking a 9-month-old pregnant woman for a date. It's like, I'm a little busy right now. Let me get this done and catch my breath. So it's been enormous undertaking here and a great ride, and there's so much more that'll happen because of the film, and you know, we take it a day at a time and enjoy the process. It's an amazing experience. Amazing.
Well, the joy of having somebody take your work and actually care about it and care for it is a unique and special thing in this business. So if you wrote another book about some other crazy thing, it probably wouldn't be as happy unless George and Grant made it.
The Italians say vediamo, we shall see.
And for you guys, back to work just in everything else you're doing? And
well, right now we're here doing all, you know, getting this movie out, and George is you know, acting in a film now, and then once everything's done, probably like beginning of March, we'll sit down like we did and we'll say, okay, what are we gonna do now, and we'll figure it out. We got a few things brewing, but nothing, I mean, we have other movies we're making as producers, but in terms of what we'll do next, we don't know.
But you'll talk about it as soon as this spring.
We will.
About it,
oh, we will, yeah. We'll probably start talking about it, yeah, like mid-February, when this when this is all open and out.
And then will it just pop up like a turkey timer?
No, there's a couple things.
That's the thing?
A couple things we have brewing and a couple things, you know, but usually they come from someplace that we don't expect, like this, yeah, you know. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so you just roll with the fates, and when the feeling is right, you guys will just know it.
Exactly.
And you'll hug and kiss and say?
We don't do a lot of kissing. try not to kiss too much.
But I mean, is it like Alexander Graham Bell? Is somebody, you know, go, I hear him on the other end of the line. I mean, is that big moment where?
No, it's not a, not really. It's more, it's much, I mean, because, you know, we're not, you know, we're not like curing polio or something. We're just making movies.
But I mean, once you dive in, you're there for a couple of years. That's a big.
It is a bit. It is a big thing. So you have to love. You have to love what it is. Right, so, for instance, in this case, you have to go. You have to love it. And so far, we haven't done what we haven't. You know, we haven't done anything we didn't love. And I guess that's part of the recipe that I would recommend to anybody who's, you know, anybody who has, it's a labor of love.
You're in the sweet spot of life when you can be focusing on projects that you're passionate about.
Yeah, that is true. Lucky.